So I will start with that question. Our ancient commentators were confined to their, in modern terms, to their ivory towers, their mathas. They were not concerned with the lives of the common people. So they were arguing in favor of X, in favor of Y, Ramanuja against Shankaracharya, Madhvacharya against this Acharya and that Acharya. Modern interpreters, Professor Narsaray has rightly pointed out, are dealing with the lives of the people at large. And we are supposed, the unfortunate part of, we may say, the Hindu tradition is that our knowledge of religion and culture is confined to the texts, and the texts were confined to the mathas. Now, during the last 150 years, there were attempts made by our scholars and our thinkers, our reformers and our spiritual leaders to bring out these, we may say, hidden texts and place them before the public. For example, Tilak was the first in modern times from Maharashtra who said that yes, Gita is very relevant to the freedom fighters' task. You cannot merely say that it was an internal fight between the higher soul and the lower soul, or the Vasana and the Vasudeva. Now this is, spiritually this is a fact, but historically you are doing injustice to Lord Sri Krishna, who became the driver of Arjun, who was not a paid servant or paid, even a paid driver today will say, I am very busy, my wife is not good, therefore I can't come along with you to Kargil. Is there any guru in this country who is prepared to accompany modern Arjun to the battlefield? But Krishna did. Therefore, Krishnam Vande Jagat Guru is one of the basic sutras accepted by some of the commentators in modern times. That Krishna was a living being. He was a perfect incarnation of the divine, and he came here to demonstrate the ideal human life. And he personally lived this type of life. And it was he again who also somehow he had some idea, because Arjun represents all of us. Even Shankaracharya accepted this. Arjunam nimittikritya, his Bhagavad Gita is conveyed to the masses at large. But unfortunately, our Sanskrit language was declared as the language of the gods, and gods reside where you know where. Therefore, our language was also the language of the, we may say, the popular language of the heavenly beings. Where they lived, I don't know. This was very unfortunate. In modern times, we can't do this. In 1947, Ambedkar and C.V. Raman, one scientist and one thinker, openly said that let Sanskrit be the national language of this country. And our forefather did not do this. Therefore, we have to face the consequences of all these things. Now, Israel came into existence, and immediate declaration was, Hebrew will be the national language, and it will be, there will be a university to study Hebrew language. Why did this not happen in this country in 1947? Where were our leaders? What were they doing? And Bhagavad Gita guided the Krantikaris, guided the revolutionary thinkers, guided men like Tilak. When Tilak, some of the views are orthodox, and still Tilak is prepared to say that Bhagavad Gita will help us to guide the masses to rise against the foreign rule, the unjust rule. A small country of hardly 1 crore people in those days is ruling over us, a country of 25 crores, and supposed to be the country where the culture was the first thing which appeared in this country. Because Vedic Sanskrit is highly developed language. Unless you study Panini, the Sanskrit scholars are here. I don't know even the ABC of Sanskrit. But they say, now see, even Pakistan is proud of Panini. And we don't know anything about Panini. Do you know this fact? This is a historical fact. Because Panini's residence belongs to Peshawar area. And our enemy country, we are supposed to be the enemy countries, it is proud of our Panini. And unless you know Panini, how can you know Sanskrit? The Vedas, but unfortunately, Vedas were confined to the mathas. Vedas stands for Vijigishur Jivanvad, and all the 5 Acharyas have openly declared that Bhagavad Gita gives you the essence of the Vedas. I am not saying this. I am too small to make such declarations. But they have said this, why Bhagavad Gita could not become the language, would not become the text of the people at last during the last 2000 years? It's a big question for me. Almost 80% Hindus are Vaishnavas. Almost 80%. Either they are worshippers of Ram or Sri Krishna or Vishnu, or Vishnu in some other form. Do you agree with me? Almost 80%. Why Gita could not become the language, we may say, of the people at large during the last 2000 years? Even Vaishnavas, it's a tragedy that Vaishnavas don't know this Bhagavad Gita. They don't teach. Swaminarayan sect, yes, I am coming to the same because I am talking about the journey of the Bhagavad Gita. And my first point is the journey of the Bhagavad Gita. You will be again surprised. The Bhagavad Gita went to the West for the first time and at the hands of the Western man. He was Sir William Jones. He came here in 1783 as a judge, and his intense desire was to study Sanskrit. I don't know where from he got this. And he accepted all the conditions of a Brahmin teacher who will teach him Sanskrit, and became a Sanskrit scholar, and he was the first to translate Bhagavad Gita into English at about, say, 1890. Again, he was the first to establish Asiatic Society of Bengal in 1784, and it became the research center so far as the east, the past of the Asia is concerned, and especially the past of this country is concerned. And he translated Bhagavad Gita into English. That translation was in the hands of Carlyle. When Emerson met Carlyle, one of the copies was given to Emerson as a gift by Carlyle in the first few decades of 19th century, when there was no Vivekananda, there was no one from the East to go to the West along with the Bhagavad Gita or the Upanishads and so on. This is the journey. Journey of Bhagavad Gita begins with Asiatic Society. Gita goes to the West, and Emerson and Thoreau says, I take bath in the thoughts of Bhagavad Gita every morning. So this is very surprising. It is the Westerners who recognize the greatness of Bhagavad Gita, and our Acharyas also recognize the greatness of Bhagavad Gita. Unfortunately, Gita remained confined to the mutts. And the people who brought out this Bhagavad Gita to the masses, just as he has mentioned, Ishwaran and others, Pandurang Shastri is one of them, who was not interested in interpreting and reinterpreting the Bhagavad Gita. He was mainly interested in taking the Bhagavad Gita to the villages. How can this be done? His father was a Sanskrit scholar. His grandfather was a man educated in modern learning, especially English literature. And his father established Bhagavad Gita Pathshala. I think it's the rare Pathshala in the history of this culture, which was a public Pathshala. Pathshala meant for the masses, which was established in 1926. And Dadaji started lecturing from this pulpit, Pathshala pulpit, from 1942. But how can a man who is educated only in the old learning or in the modern learning be the adhikari of lecturing on Bhagavad Gita? So it was very surprising that this Vaidyanath Shastri Ji Atavale, the father of Pandurang Shastri Atavale, established a special school, Saraswati Sanskrit Pathshala, at Roha, Shirdi Deshmukh's village. It was almost a village, very obscure village. And he was studying in modern school here, and he recalled him from the school, took him to his Roha town and said that you must study Nyaya Shastra, Vyakaran Shastra, and along with this modern sciences and especially English literature. Because it was again Lokmanya Tilak who showed that unless you try to place this Bhagavad Gita before the modern mind in the light of modern thinkers, especially Sidgwick is there, J.S. Mill is there, Kant is there, see, unless you know this, you can't properly understand Gita Rahasya. He knew this very well. Therefore, along with the Nyaya Shastra and Vyakaran Shastra, he made a provision to teach him English literature. And for 10 years he was, now I am saying this so smoothly, but it was not a very smooth affair. Everybody was against his decision, that you are doing something wrong. Panurang is capable of becoming an ICS officer, and he is sending him back to this small town just to study this old vidyas. What is the use of these old vidyas in modern times? And only this Pandurang, who was hardly 12 years old, supported his father's decision and went there and studied. And from 1942, he started giving his talks on Bhagavadgita in Bhagavadgita Pashala, which is still there in Girgaon, for the public consumption. And after the departure of his father, he realized that Bhagavadgita now must reach the masses. And from 1955 onwards, he started. His father left this world in 1952, and then he started thinking of extending this Pathshala premises, we may say. Why not the whole country to become a Pathshala? And he started this in a very unique way. He established Tatvajnan Vidyapit at Thane with full faith in God's existence and the ways of God. Because if I am delivering lectures on Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavan says, Ananyas Sintayanto Mam, Ejana Paripasate, 922 verse, 9 chapter is very important so far as bhakti is concerned. He was Jnaneshwar Maharaj, because Maharashtra has a very peculiar history. It was Jnaneshwar Maharaj who was prepared to, we may say, face the onslaught of the orthodox Brahmins, because he was the first in the cultural history of India to comment upon Bhagavad Gita in the language of the masses. And he was very much abused in those days. So, Jnaneshwar did this very important work during the last decades of 13th century, 700 years back this happened. And then Tilak and so many others also wrote on Bhagavad Gita. But here is a peculiar method. Why not tell the ordinary people in the text of the Bhagavad Gita and through, we may say, a peculiar method of bhakti? Because ultimately the problem is how to translate the principles of Bhagavad Gita into action is a problem. So he started engaging camps in Tatvajnan Vidyapit for those who conducted, we may say, samskar kendras for the young kids, then the grihasthas, householders, then the sadhakas, who are old people, then for undergraduates and for postgraduates. These five top sites of educative camps continued for almost 30 years. And in 3 years, that is 56, 57, 58, in 58 he started one important project based on the thoughts of Bhagavad Gita, which is called Bhakti Feri. This is a very important thing. He said that if you want to do Bhakti, so first thing is try to understand Bhakti. Bhakti is an understanding, it is an attitude. And bhakti, this can be expressed in actions, and through peculiar type of action, this can be developed. This is what he did silently for the next 25 years. And he started this process with hardly 18 youngsters in March 1958. Educate them, ask them to perform bhakti in the form of action-oriented bhakti, which he called Pruti Bhakti. So there is Bhav Bhakti, it's a matter of your heart, it's a matter of your mind, it's a matter of what you call nowadays you are talking about internal life. But externally, it is to be expressed through certain actions, action-oriented bhakti. We called it Pruti Bhakti. So, your leisure time, he never emphasized Shankara's asceticism. He was actually a follower of Shankaracharya. Our Jnaneshwar Maharaj also, in a sense, to some extent, was a follower of Shankaracharya. Because he himself says, Vashyakarate Vatakosadu, I am following the Vashyakar and interpreting the Bhagavad Gita in the language of the people at large. So Shankaracharya was well known so far as the scholarly struggle of this state was concerned. And with the help of this, we may say, this Machindracharya, Machindranath, Gorakhnath, Gaininath. Gaininath was the guru of, we may say, Jnaneshwara's family. It was Gayinath who conveyed this message to Nirutinath that Bhagavad Gita, the Krishna cult must be revived and properly developed and taken to the masses. Yoga is all right. Yoga means this is the yoga and all these things. This is all right for individuals. But what about the masses? They are totally alienated from your scriptures. Nobody knows Bhagavad Gita. Now there are 6 lakh villages in India. How many temples are there to organize lectures on Bhagavad Gita? It's a rare thing. There are some mythologies. Some mythological stories, people are acquainted with certain mythological stories. Stories about Ram, stories about Krishna, stories about Nachiketa. Such things are there because of Ramayana and Mahabharata. But the authentic texts are never taken to the masses at large in this country. Pandurang Shastri did this. Now there are thousands of villages, thousands of fishermen localities where Shankaracharya's sotras are recited. And in all these camps, every day there will be 2 santa periods. Sanskrit people know what is santa. Santa yane, the method of reciting the slokas, the method of learning them by heart. So, suppose the simple thing in Ananyas Chintoma, utter this for 7 times, half of this 7 times, full for 7 times, and young people can master this language. Sanskrit friends, though I am not a man of Sanskrit, I can tell you, and I hear there are Sanskrit scholars, genuine Sanskrit scholars, they will agree with me, that Sanskrit is far easier than English. English is, in a sense, an uncultured language. I say this from your standpoint. Go, went, gone. How will you explain when? I don't know how to explain when. Why go, God, gone? It's understandable. Go, God, go, G-O-E-D. Add E-D and you get past tense, something like this. And then gone. So Sanskrit, so it was again Sir William Jones who said that Sanskrit language is superior to Greek and Latin language. It's a very drastic statement made 200 years back by a man who represented the ruling class and he was praising the language of the ruled. Is not this extraordinary? But who is that for? So this is how the journey of Bhagavad Gita from India towards England, then from England to America and again back to India. But what about the masses of this country? Ours is the country which is competing with China in regard to population. And still, we are not aware of Bhagavad Gita. Our yoga has reached, Iyengar has established centers of yoga in China. Yoga is popular everywhere today. And yoga is more than 2000 years old. Who is that called? Who is responsible for this? We are. This man never went on giving lectures of this type. He silently worked and he said, this is my bhakti. And as a part of your bhakti, you go to your villages without collecting funds. In order to organize this seminar, our directors had to appeal to the people and pay at least 200 rupees. And there is nothing wrong in this. But this man never did this. You know, Pandurang Shastri is responsible, in a sense, is responsible for the establishment of this institution. I know it, because I am associated with him for the last 52 years. The foundation stone of this college was laid at the auspicious hands of Pandurang Shastri Atoka. And he had made provision to teach Bhagavad Gita in this college, and he had appointed 2 professors. One Paramanand Gandhi, earlier there was another fellow, and they were supposed to teach Bhagavad Gita in the colleges. Whether the people listen to you or not, that is immaterial. Our usual complaint is, oh, youngsters are not interested in Bhagavad Gita. But have you ever tried to place this material in a marketing orientation? In modern times, we talk about marketing orientation. We have been listening to the lectures on management and Bhagavad Gita. The point is, whatever it may be, unless there is bhakti, unless there is bhakti, means bhakti, translate your management. The term management is a very strange term. That is also not my subject.
Don't worry, I will manage this.
What is the meaning of this? You know. You know the meaning. What Gita has to do with this? What Gita has to do with this type of management? Oh, don't worry, I will minister in my uncle, maternal uncle, I will manage, don't worry. You just declare and everything will be provided to you, including the police security and so on. Are what is all this? Bhagavad Gita was born on the battlefield and every day we have to face that problem of struggle. Life is a struggle. Call it struggle, call it play. We have to fight it out. And Bhagavad Gita is the best book to give us, we may say, proper guidance. Because Bhagavad Gita's God is not in heaven. About Socrates, they say Socrates brought philosophy from heaven to earth and took it to the marketplace. Same is true of Bhagavad Gita. Sri Krishna said, I am seated in your heart. Don't worry. Unfortunately, you know there is one picture, and I was told by one of my students that, have you seen this? You must see this. And the picture is, oh my God. I requested him, what is the gist of this picture? And he said, oh, Hindus are afraid of God. I said, totally wrong. Majority of you are Hindus. Are you afraid of God? You are afraid of Shani Maharaj. Therefore, our sisters are fighting for entry into that Shani Maharaj temple. Nobody questions, why should there be Shani temple in this country when God resides in all? Nobody asks this question. Therefore, people are afraid of philosophy. I am a student of philosophy. I am asking this question to you. Anybody can come and answer this question. Why are we afraid of Shani? We are afraid of Shani, not afraid of God. We are afraid of Ghosh. We are afraid of so many other things. How many of us are afraid of? I at the university counter, there were two taxi men, and both of them were Muslims. One Muslim driver tells another Muslim driver, see, have fear of Allah only. Don't be afraid of any other force on this earth. One driver was telling another driver. It's a fact. I heard this, I was shocked. That ordinary man is teaching the most fundamental principle of every religion, I would say. And our Shastriji, who is known as Dadaji, he always said that, don't be afraid of God, doesn't matter. But try to love God, try to understand His love for us. Our Jnaneshwar 700 years back said, approach Gita, answer to your question, as a child, not as a Sanskrit scholar, not as a hair-splitting scholar. So in Maharashtra, Gita is known as Ai, mother. Gita Ai. Vinobaji wrote a book, Gita Ai. Your God is also Vithoba or Krishna is also known as Ai, mother. So Vithai and Gita Ai. So approach Bhagavad Gita as a child and you will be able to get the milk, Gita Mrutam, milk. And if you approach it as a tick, you will get blood. Do you want to be a blood sucker or do you want to be a milk drinker? Then your approach must be approach of a kind of devotee. Shastriji's approach to Bhagavad Gita is the approach of a devotee. And once we say devotee, then we are again reminded of Sai travels. The number of Sai travels is increasing like anything. It's not a good sign. It's a problem, again, management. It's again a problem of management. I am telling you the truth. It's not a sign of this. Sai Baba is a very ordinary fakir who said, there is only one father of this universe. Sabka Malik Ek. Have faith in the Malik. And wait, don't be in a hurry. This simple message is not conveyed by the Shirdi Shrine, and Shirdi Shrine is competing with Balaji. It's very strange. All these things are very strange. All this is outer show. You understand this? So try to go to the roots of Bhagavad Gita, and Bhagavan Sri Krishna had, I think he had, must have this idea that Arjuna is going to falter when he will see Dronacharya, and himself has said, Pujarha. In today's language, we will say Param Pujya Dronacharya, Param Pujya Bhishmacharya. They are on the wrong side and I have to hit them. How can I? Will you do this? If such a situation arises. So he knew that Arjuna is going to have this problem. So Arjuna was totally mentally paralyzed. Mentally. Bodily he was alright. Gandivam Samsate Hastat. Gandiv simply slipped out of his hands. He did not throw the Gandiv. But he had to pick up the Gandiv when he listened to this. And our Pandurang Shastri Athavaliji says, you have faith in this indwelling divine, Antaryami. This is also an English word, maybe new. But our Acharyas have used the word, even Upanishads have used the word, God is Antaryami. He resides within and controls from within. And there is rational meaning in this. This is not the language of Bhav. And he tries to explain this in a very simple language. How do you sleep? Know this? You do you know this? How do you sleep? All right, if you sleep, somehow you sleep. Do you know how do you get up? These are very simple arguments. You don't know how you enter into sleep. You don't know how you get out of sleep. Then who was looking after you? And who were you? You were neither professor, you were neither great scholar, you were neither nobody, not organizer, not attending the sefir. If somebody is sleeping here, you just ask him, who were you during the sleeping period? So nobody. But you were there. Who was looking after you? This is divine management. This is divine management. So why not accept this? We may say daily experience fact is each was life and pay tribute to him. So it is a kind of prayer of thanksgiving. There is no question of demanding from him. He has given a lot because nobody knows who he is. Schopenhauer was just passing through a road and he saw the garden and he just entered the garden and tried to smell the flowers because it was very nice in the morning. So the owner of the garden said, who are you? Schopenhauer told him. He again went down and asked him, I am doing the same thing. I am trying to find out who am I. Have you got the answer? The same is true of me and I. Is there anyone who knows himself or herself completely? I am prepared to learn from you. Here in this audience. No. If you say, yes, who are you? Yes, he is Swamiji. Swamiji, this is a rhetorical question. He should be allowed. It is up to you.
Let him complete then.
After completion. So our Shastriji's very simple message is, it is very difficult to imitate. We can imitate Saint Tukaram if you are performing the part of Tukaram in a cinema or in a drama. But the dress will not transform you into Tukaram Maharaj. Isn't it? This is a very simple thing. But still you can understand him and try to, we may say, walk on the pathway which he has walked. Saint Tukaram said, Deva gya fuka na lage ruka. And we are reading news in newspapers, the darshan prices are increasing for the elite. How will you reconcile this? Are we not defeating the message of this, the saints of this country? Deva gya fuka, take God free of charge. Bhagavan ka naam lene ko ek paisa nahi lagta hai. And whenever you go to Balaji, you come back a disappointed person. Dejected person. Oh, I could not see him properly. Darshan barabar hua hi nahi. This is found in everybody's mouth. Now my simple message is, with whose power you walked up to Balaji? You are not prepared to use your reason for your inner structure. With whose power you went up to Balaji? You forget this. So take the simple message. to see Balaji is to be seen by Balaji. I could not see Balaji when I went to Balaji. Balaji has seen me. This is a very simple truth. The saints have declared. Why don't you accept this? And try to learn from this and try to practice it. It becomes difficult, all right. So you have some leisure time, you go to Lonavala, you go to Mahabaleshwar. Why not go to villages for 15 days? There is no need to collect funds. So from 1958 onwards, so to some extent, why I am saying this, his interpretation of Bhagavad Gita can be seen in his work. Therefore, I am referring to this. There is no need to read every stroke and every word which is explained by him analytically or synthetically in all sorts of things. But his work itself is an expression of, we may say, his commentary on the Bhagavad Gita. But there is no time because we have to follow these restrictions, though in metaphysics we say time is unreal. Here we have to follow the timetable and the director is also looking at us. The main point is his work and the last, I will see something about the last verse of Bhagavad Gita. Last verse is known as the gist of Bhagavad Gita. Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Partho Dhanurdhara, Tatra Sri Vijayo Bhutir Dhruva Nitir. This declaration is not made by Dharmaraj or Arjun or Sri Krishna. This declaration is made by a man from the enemy camp. This is a wonderful verse. This is Sanjay's declaration. Sanjay was an official reporter of Dhritarashtra. And this statement is made in front of Dhritarashtra. That is the context. Because he was a reporter. So he says, my dear boss, he was his boss, Arjun is going to win the battle. Because Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Partho Dharmadara. He said, this shloka is known as Ekeshwari Gita. So, take it. His simple commentary is, God is with you. He works with you. If you work, He works. So, it's a message of effortism. At the same time, devotionalism. Dhanyavad.
Chair these two this session having two papers which have brought the text of the Bhagavad Gita to the common masses. Dr. Madhavi Narsale's paper on Eknath Ishwaran having leaning to spiritual thoughts and meditation, the man was, and his voluminous three commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita, and then through that he had the samvada actually with the audience, which is very much needed in this age. We have left long back the age of textual interpretations and then those arguments and etc. What we need in this age is, what are the texts for the well-being of this world, which is divided into two main categories, haves and have-nots. So what the text give us, that's very important. And from that point of view, Madhavi's paper was very nice. She gave us a perfect idea of the commentary of Eknath Ishwaran, his 8-point meditation program, and then his scholarly knowledge wedded to the needs of the worldly man. Searching principles in the philosophy of the Bhagavad Gita. She has also spoken about the relation of the Sankhya philosophy and the Bhagavad Gita. Tireless service to the world around, and a person, Though he is following actionless action, still how he is useful for the tirelessly for this world. Then I come to Dr. Nigar's paper. I am fortunate to have attended two or three discourses by Dadaji, long back, in 70s. And I have personally experienced how his style was very lucid, very simple. It could immediately touch the heart of the audience. And you know, villages are villages after villages, and especially the all the fishermen community. It's not a joke. My friends, remember, it's not a joke to make these people free of the habit of drinking. Completely. When they give the words, when they gave the words to Dadaji, no drinks, yes. For the whole of the life, they have abandoned that habit. It can't be achieved by any government law of prohibition. Remember, it is only through the heart that the man has. And I'm glad that it's not only charity begins at home. He has trained his daughter so well. And when I was in Elphinstone long back I was in Elphinstone in 70s, I had taught her Sanskrit. And later on she switched over to PhD philosophy, and then she took her PhD in philosophy. She very loving child, right from the beginning, very obedient, very modest student, not having any airs of her father, remember. She was very, very cordial to other friends, to professors of Elphinstone College, and she is managing the whole thing now, remember. Jayashree Athavale Talwalkar. She is managing the whole Swadhyaya Mandal, remember. And there was a class 3 staff member in my department when I was heading the Sanskrit department, Bombay University, Mumbai University. So his sister got married, and with very meager means it was, and to get the sister married was his responsibility, that class responsibility. We attended the marriage, and it was so disciplined, remember, with limited means, how in a disciplined manner a well wedding can be arranged because of this Swadhyaya Mandala, Dadaji's Krupa, because his family was has been the, you know, the devotee of Dadaji. So I have seen. It is not bookish knowledge, remember, of Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita, rather than being caged in the library stacks, it is brought to the common masses. That is what we want in this age, remember. So this is all about two papers, and now my small comments. I won't take much time. I'm known for short speech. Yes, short, and then they sweet. They say sweet also, I don't know. So, Gita is a very good example of our religious thought, which deals with two main principles, change and continuity. We want continuity with the past, at the same time we want to introduce changes. But those changes are gently introduced. It's not a very bold step just to wipe up old and then bring new. No, this has not been the tradition of our country, remember. So at that time the yajnas were performed in the society, because sacrifice has been the hub of this civilization, of this culture. So sacrifices were being performed, but then therefore, the author of the Gita took the concept of yajna, put it in a new light. Yajna chakra, he introduced, because yajna is very important, action is important. So dravya yajna, tapo yajna, yoga yajna, so many yajnas. So yajna concept was taken. And then, because yajna is regarded as the sukrutasya yonihi, it is the It is the birthplace of order, very order in the society. Cosmic order, moral order, sacrificial order. Ruta they call. So it was that, and then, but then he gave a new turn. He introduced karma, their importance of karma, because of the Upanishadic philosophy and then the sannyasa movement in the in the society. In the Mruchakatika, there is a sentence. This sannyasaha kuladushanaihi avanataha meghaihi vrutaha chandramaha. As the moon is just made invisible by the clouds, similarly, this very beautiful, very sane concept of sannyasa is just shrouded in mystery by persons who are ill-equipped for this. Today you become a sannyasin, again enter the grihastha ashrama. That was the wave. So action was necessary in the society, so karma yoga was introduced. But for the common masses, bhakti is the only way. So striyo vaishyaha tatha shudraha tepi anti paramgatim. And why this bhakti or why this complete surrender to the God is important? This is the psychological need of the common masses, remember, when they are facing the problems day to day life, if they find something, some resort somewhere, naturally their life becomes very full of light. And this I just remind you of Freud's one essay, The Uncanny. Uncanny means uncomfortable. And he first wrote it in German. He was an Austrian scholar. He first wrote it in German, Unheimlich. See, Heim in German means house. Heimlich means homely, familiar, where we have all the love and care and the sense of belonging. Unheimlich means unfamiliar, where we feel uncomfortable, which is very new to us, which is very insecure atmosphere for us. And if this insecure atmosphere is there, the man goes in depression. The man goes in repression. He has the nervous breakdown. So, in order to be away from that, the man seeks some kind of resort. Maybe one of his parents, mother or father. See, when we are very much in trouble, even when you are a very grown-up person, you will remember your mother or father, because we want some kind of support. Now, why don't we have support of the God, resort to the God, complete surrender to the God? So this is the psychological need of the common people in the society. And the later chapters of the Bhagavad Gita are full of devotion. So in this manner, the Bhagavad Gita is, all encompassing work. That is what, and that's why it has kept its popularity for all these ages, and it will be like that. The eternal, book of India. Thank you very much.
I request Chairperson Dr. Dange Madam to felicitate both the speakers. I request Mrs. Prachi Pathak, in charge principal of KJ Somaya Bharatiya Sanskriti Peetham, to felicitate Dr. Dange Madam. Now we will wait for the tea break. The arrangement for the tea is there outside the auditorium, and we are going to start our next session in 15 minutes.
Upasthitebhyah sarvebhyah pandit pravarebhyah tatha manyavarebhyah sadaram sarvebhyo namo namaha. I am Balasaheb Uva. I feel privileged to welcome you all on behalf of KJ Somaya Bharatiya Sanskriti Peetham to the third seminar on the national seminar on the modern commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita. I now request today's chairperson, Dr. Uma Shankar, to kindly occupy the chair on the dais. Dr. Uma Shankar is the Vice Principal and Head, Department of the Philosophy, SIS College of Science, Mumbai. Thank you, Madam. I now request our speaker, Dr. Manjiri Gokhale, to kindly occupy the chair on dais. Dr. Manjiri Gokhale has done her MA and PhD in music. She is actively working in the field of music and voice culture. Thank you, Madam. I now request Dr. Geeta Mehta to kindly occupy the chair on dais. Dr. Geeta Mehta is an adjunct professor at KJ Somaiya Center for Studies in Jainism. Dr. Geeta Mehta. I request to chairperson to start the session. Dr. Uma Shankar.
At the outset, I am extremely privileged and honored to chair the session on the commentaries on Gita. I sincerely thank Dr. Kala Acharya for inviting me to chair this session. Right from morning, we have been hearing a wonderful commentaries, especially the modern commentaries on Gita. And I don't think we are going to turn any stone unturned in the next 2 days, today and tomorrow. And once again, as the continuity of the commentaries going on, we are going to listen to two more interesting areas on the commentaries. One, Oshu, I'll reserve my comments a little later after she finishes the paper. One, who have been rather most misguided, misinterpreted and not much understood, a great scholar and a great writer too. So we're going to listen to Osho's commentary on the Gita by Manjiri first. It will be followed by Vinoba's commentary by Gita, by veteran Dr. Geeta Mehta, who has worked so much seriously on the topic on Vinoba and Gandhi. Welcome both of you here, and we shall take the paper first. Okay? Thank you.
Let us all invoke the gurus first, all the gurus. Brahmanandam Paramasukhadam Kevalam Jnanamurtim Dvandvatitam Gaganasadrusham Tattvamasyadilaksham Ekam Nityam Vimalamachalam Sarvadhi Sakshibhutam Bhavatitam Trigunarahitam Sadguru Tam Nama. I invoke blessings from all my teachers and all the jnanis, all the scholars and teachers sitting here. I start my presentation now on Osho's commentary on the Bhagavad Gita. Osho was an enlightened master and mystic of the 20th century. Being of rebellious nature and having extraordinary public speaking skills, clarity and humor, he was the most debated master of his time. He was paradoxical, yet a profound and compassionate teacher. He has given thousands of discourses on mystical, spiritual and philosophical scriptures, people and mystics of the world, both ancient and modern. 21st March 1953 was Osho's Enlightenment Day. Today I feel blessed and happy to speak on Osho's commentary on this day, on Bhagavad Gita. This is an auspicious day for me. I thank the organizers for inviting me here for this sharing. मी तुमची खूपच ऋणी आहे. It is beyond my capacity to understand and explain Osho and his commentary on Bhagavad Gita, Krishna. Krishna and Osho, both being enlightened beings, always live from moment to moment. They talk from and talk about a dimension which has light and is beyond time and space, which is beyond our living and experience dimensions. Osho gave a series of 219 discourses in Hindi under the title Gita Darshan over a period of 5 years on the most popular scripture Srimad Bhagavad Gita. They are published in book form in 8 volumes. All the 219 audios of the discourses are available as free downloads on internet on many websites. Gita Darshan's first discourse was given in a meditation camp at Ahmedabad on 29th November 1970 and the last discourse on 10th August 1975 at his Pune ashram. Every discourse would be approximately from 1 hour 15 to 30 minutes. Bhagavad Gita, the sadhana and smriti prasthan of the prasthanatrayi, according to Osho, is the pointer to go beyond the chitta by understanding the behavior and nature of the chitta. Osho says, according to me, I would call Krishna the father of psychology. Osho, as far as I remember, has not mentioned the phrases prasthanatrayi, sadhana or smriti prasthan. While speaking on the 700 shlokas, he has termed the shlokas as sutras. All the discourses are a combination of explanation of the shlokas and answers, question and answer sessions which were happening during the discourses. In every discourse, he has given prime importance to experience and sadhana. He explains in a unique way which is absolutely non-philosophical. He includes stories, incidents and quotes of many enlightened masters' thoughts. He includes Zen stories. He includes Mullah Nasruddin jokes, stories of ancient and modern rishis, thinkers, warriors, scientists and many personalities. Though he does not compare scriptures and people, he refers to their method of speaking and explaining. His way of explanation is by referring to teachings of Buddha, Mahavir, Socrates, Muhammad Paigambar, Jesus, Abraham, Lao Tzu, Shankaracharya, Jay Krishnamurti, Meera, Kabir and other masters. He also refers to Hitler, the Hiroshima Nagasaki destruction, scientists and psychologists like Archimedes, Madame Marie Curie, Freud, Carl Jung and so on. This is just a short list I have given, especially on Gita Darshan. Just a short list I have given. He explains with life incidents and thinking styles of many more. He explains with an unusual perspective, going beyond the dimensions of philosophy. Osho's discourses are not scholarly discussions. Osho used to say, you have to practice Sakshi Bhav, which is, I'm bit of less in the Sakshi Bhav, not able to press the key at the right moment. Osho's discourses are not scholarly discussions. Masters like Krishna and Osho live moment to moment and are omnipresent. They keep on changing perspectives and dimensions now and then. Many times they speak from multiple perspectives and multiple dimensions simultaneously. That is the reason that minds that are dominant with logic, knowledge and philosophy fail to understand them. We fail to practice the sadhana preached by these enlightened beings. We get stuck up in the mind game of knowledge and information and forget that the Bhagavad Gita is supposed to be practiced and not learnt. As said earlier, it is beyond anyone's capacity to understand and explain Osho and his commentary on Bhagavad Gita. Throughout the discourses, he has emphasized on the point several times that it is not possible to understand what Krishna wants to say and how Krishna is grooming his disciple. We can understand only by practicing Sakshi Sadhana, practicing awareness and meditation on the shlokas and surrender to him. He says that we have to become Arjunas. Means we have to go in the role of Arjuna to understand Krishna. We have to go to the peak level of Vishada to understand Krishna. Osho speaks, and I am going to say some points at a glance. To avoid repetitions and to give due respect to the allotted time, I would be explaining in this presentation few points which are unique to Osho. Of course, the ones which I feel are important to be told. Almost all these points have been repeated over many chapters in different words and context. I am giving them in a compiled form. Osho says that if you feel that I have talked a lot on Gita, because it was 219 discourses, it is not because I am influenced by Krishna, but because Krishna said the same things I am saying. He also says Gita Darshan is not about knowledge, but about experience. Osho says, Krishna is telling Arjuna to practice Sakshi Bhav in every action, every gap and silence throughout the 18 chapters. The commander-in-chief of Kaurava, who was Bhishma, blowed the conch to declare the readiness, vigor, challenge and happiness to begin the war. Now the reply should have been given by the commander-in-chief of Pandavas, who was Drushtadyumna, but it was Krishna who took the responsibility of the reply as the acceptance to Bhishma's challenge, because it should be equally happy response. He responds to avoid a wrong reaction full of anger and hatred, which would have been from Drushtadyumna. Three levels of personalities are there, according to Osho. Vicharahin, wrong decision, vichara, indecision, and nirvichara, right decision. At first level, that is vicharahin level, war happens. At this level, one is vicharahin. Vicharahinta means wrong thinking, wrong logic, represented by Duryodhan and Bhim in the Mahabharat war. The level is of decision, which is always wrong, anger, hatred and himsa, having instinct for violence. The second level is of vichara, knowledge, doubt. This is the stage of indecisiveness, escape, vishad, sorrow. Arjun was on this stage. From wrong thinking, we tend to shift to just the opposite of decision, which is indecision. That too is wrong. Peripheral calmness is seen, which is actually fear of action rising out of fear of taking wrong decision. Love, which is an opposite of hate, surfaces which can become hate at any moment. Mamatva surfaces an instinct of possessiveness, fear of loss of relations. Mamatva is the opposite of himsa. It is not ahimsa. Vishad happens at the peak of this stage. And the third level is of Krishna. Krishna is at the level beyond vichara and vicharahinta. It is the nirvichara, the no thought stage. He wants Arjuna to become warrior, which he is, means Arjuna is, with Sakshi Bhav awareness. This would help him to go beyond the antardvandva, inner war, and reach the nirvichara level. Nirvichara, no thought, is not opposite of vichara, thought. Opposite of thought is vicharahinta, thoughtlessness. In thoughtlessness, the possibility of thought, latent thoughts, unexpressed thoughts are present. But no thought is a level beyond thoughts, beyond the mind. On the periphery, both seem to be same. This is the ahimsa level. The opposite of himsa is not ahimsa. Opposite of himsa is mamatva. They are the opposite sides of a mind, which derive from the thoughts of mine and your, I and you. In the mind, awareness of all is mine or nothing is mine develop. Both himsa and mamatva rise from the fear of losing all that is mine, rise from the desire of gaining all that is not mine. The action of himsa is anger, war, jealousy, hate, etc. And mamatva prefers passiveness, which is seen as indifference, depression, escaping from action, etc. But Arjun was full of fear of losing his relatives from both sides. That is why he was trembling and losing all strength. He became totally depressed. Arjun was trying to choose the opposite of war, which is not peace. If Arjun would have been saying that I will not fight out of real ahimsa, Krishna would have told him to leave the battlefield immediately. If ahimsa would have been his swabhava, his nature, then Gita would not have happened at all. At another place, Osho says, there is nothing called as himsa. There is only desire of himsa, harming, violence. One likes to and enjoys harming or violence. The act of harming or violence is not bad. It is the desire and enjoyment feeling that is a sin. Similarly, ahimsa is neither good or bad. The desire of not harming is bad. There is nothing called as ahimsa. There is only desire of saving, desire of not being violent, desire of not having harming. A person who is full of happiness is creative, whereas a person full of madness and insanity becomes himsa, violent, a person like Hitler. At the cosmic level, there is nothing called as himsa, violence. But at the bhava level, the mind level, which is the desire level, there is himsa, there is violence. He says knowing is of two types. Manna develops beliefs and janna develops trust. Manna is connected with shastras, scriptures, and janna is connected with experience. The knowledge connected with scriptures becomes our beliefs. The knowledge connected with our experience becomes trust, shraddha. Knowledge of scriptures is dangerous and creates brahma, false notion of being experienced. Trust can be developed by facing the moment-to-moment yuddha, war or sangharsha. The friction of life is always with our own relatives. Don't lose this opportunity. Wake up, become strong, awaken your wisdom. Unless we put to stake our whole life like Arjuna, Krishna cannot be understood. Unless we choose Krishna alone against his whole strong army, we cannot understand Krishna. Then Krishna becomes a charioteer, sarthi. Our sarthi, our Krishna, lies within us. Krishna's strong army is all the strength of the scriptures and knowledge available. We have to choose to go in search of the silent sarthi within. Meditation is the path to search the silent sarthi within. Real surrender can happen only with strong sankalpa, will and desire and a strong heart. For developing a strong sankalpa, strong ahankara, ego is necessary. There is no meaning to a weak person's surrender. Sankalpa comes with ego, the head. It also represents dominance, buddhi, vichara. If it becomes the doer, the karta, means if the sankalpa becomes the doer or karta, the master, it becomes the cause of anybody's downfall. But if it becomes the object, the akarta bhav, the helper, servant, then it becomes fruitful for one's growth. Surrender is the heart's action. Heart is interconnected of I and you. A weak heart surrender is an escape for not shouldering our responsibilities, an escape for giving the blame to others for our non-doing, for our fears. It tries to escape from being the doer. This surrender is not surrender at all. There has to be a balance between head and heart. A surrender happening with a strong ego and a strong heart is balanced and total. It took 8 long chapters for Krishna to cut the cords of doubt and so-called beliefs of Arjuna. Then he says that Arjuna's pessimistic, doubtful and escape-oriented attitude was shattered. He became a real bhakta, a person full of trust and closeness with Krishna. Bhakti is an easy path only for people who have crossed the turmoil of doubt successfully. The secrets of truth and spirituality are given to such bhaktas. Opposite of bhakta is vibhakta. A bhakta joins, synthesizes, and a vibhakta breaks, analyzes. Bhakta is strong. He is blessed with the strength of wisdom, highest knowledge, only a bhakta is capable of reaching. Gurus, teachers and scriptures are just pointers and helpers to help us to find the right path. We have to tread the path on our own. Sometimes gurus give a glimpse of the divyata, the divine, like the divya drushti, the divine inner sight given to Arjun. It is similar to the hitting of or beating and shouting of Zen masters on their disciples. This pushes beyond the physical and mental capacity of the disciples many times. But still, it is necessary for the disciple to make a shift in their sadhana. It means the push. But still, it is necessary for the disciples to make a shift in their sadhana to help them pull out from wherever the disciples are stuck up or wherever they are lingering. Gurus can only give a temporary glimpse, which will soon fade away. The disciple has to do the sadhana to gain the divine abilities. He has to become strong physically and mentally. Enlightened beings all over the world, over all times, have used contradictory words and languages, which creates a peripheral difference in the scriptures. But there is a common factor which prevails in all. It is the law of three. Jesus says Trinity, Hindus say Trimurti, Yoga says Triputi, Mahavir says Tri Ratna, Buddha says Tri Sharana, Lao Tzu says Three Treasures, Sankhya says Triguna. The first halt, stop, which he calls as Pada, in the creation process from one to many is three. The process goes on as 1 to 3, 3 to 9, 9 to 80, 81 and so on. Similarly, while returning to the source, the last halt is at 3. After 3, you don't remain as you. I doesn't remain as I. Ahankara, ego, starts at 3. Sankhyas have called the first stop of 3 in the process of creation as Trigunas, Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. Tamas is the strength of binding, being steady. It pulls you down. The force of gravitation is Tamas. Spiritual blindness is also Tamas. Tamas is heaviness. In meditation, we experience a feeling of levitation. That is because the strength of Tamas is lessened. Mental heaviness is all our worries, wrong relations, wrong decisions, wrong impressions, bad habits. Death has more Tamas in it. Excess eating, nicotine, suicidal tendencies are all Tamas. Tamas people are poor. Rajas is action, speedy. He doesn't call Tamas and Rajas, okay? He calls Tama and Raja. But I am calling it Tamas and Rajas. Rajas is action, speedy, stresses. All the problems, upadrava of the world are Rajas. Mental disorders, social activists, all mischief, fever is Rajas. Rajas people are wealthy. Tamas and Rajas are opposites. Where they are balanced, sattva is present. Meaning of balanced is the necessary amount of, meaning of balanced means the necessary amount of tamas and rajas. None is even a bit more or bit less than required. Sattva means balance, param buddhi, birth of virgin. Now there is nothing excess. There is total harmony, rhythm, trupti, a perfect understanding and collaboration of opposites. It is easier to go beyond the gunas, take a leap from the edge of the sattva. Though it is possible to go beyond, even from tamas, but it is very difficult. Very few people like Valmiki, Angulimal have reached through tamas. Basically, on a broader frame, there are two types of paths. One is Sankhya and the other is Yoga for two types of personalities. Antarmukhi, introverts and Bahirmukhi, extroverts. Sankhya is a path of Jnana, knowledge, wisdom. It needs to go in search of the micro, the inner world. Whereas Yoga is the path of Karma, action, doing. It needs to go in the search of macro, the outer world. An introvert needs to follow the Sankhya path. And an extrovert needs to follow the path of yoga. We have to choose our path according to our nature, swabhava. Usually we neither are 100% extrovert nor 100% introvert. Seva, work is the dharma, nature for extroverts, and dhyana, meditation, is the dharma for introverts. Each person is a unique combination of the two, so each person has to make his own path. No one can use the exact path of somebody else, even his guru's path. Krishna has to provoke Arjuna for war and not meditation, as he was an extrovert. An extrovert cannot become introvert and vice versa. An extrovert goes in search of Brahma outside till he finds it and declares his realization as, I am the Brahma. An introvert, on the other hand, goes for his search inside and declares his realization as shunya, nothing. Buddha used the words nirvana, meaning extinction of land. As far as the expression is concerned, they are different, but they are expressing about the same ultimate experience. When Krishna uses the word I, he speaks from two dimensions. Sometimes he speaks from the dimension inside the time frame, Samaya, where he is Arjuna's friend. But sometimes he speaks from the dimension beyond time. Then he speaks in the role of Samashti, the totality, whole, the divine level. That is the reason of contradictory shlokas and using the same words with different or contradictory meanings. It is important to understand the subtle difference of Krishna's roles within the time frame and beyond time frame. That is what every sadhaka has to do according to Osho. A person is dharmic only if he understands the roles and meanings of the contradictions. A dharmic never perceives it as contradictory, but perceives it as complementary. Sannyasi is not the one who abandons the house and society and goes to the forest. Usually he has a desire of enlightenment. It is important to leave the desire of fruits and desire itself. Sannyas means a living which has desire-free actions. Krishna has given the real meaning of sannyas. Sannyasi is a person who faces every sangharsha of life. He is not an escapist. A sannyasi uses every life incident to polish himself. He has used the word nikharna, which I didn't get a parallel English word for it. This is the real skill, the art of life. Every stone has to be used to a step forward. In war, in friction, or in the rush, bheed, this opportunity is available. Sannyas means a life of karma yoga. He has to abandon sankalpa, will. Desire becomes strong and gets converted to will when strength is gathered to fulfill the desire. Desire is ichha, wish. When desire and ego work together, desire becomes will. Sannyas is the death of the ego. To become karta, the doer, is the original sin. Worry, problems, stress begins with the karta bhav. Karma, action without karta bhav, never begets stresses. Paramatma is the only karta. We teach sankalpa. Krishna tells to abandon sankalpa, to be available to Prabhu, God. To understand the meaning of desire, desire-free actions, you should experiment for a day which is desire-free. It is like a child's play. People mistake it as game. It is necessary to understand the difference between game and play. Game has a desire of winning. Play is just for the sake of playing, desire-free. Only the persons who are ready for failure can become free from the desire of fruits of action. This can be achieved even by living in the here, and now, that is in the present. Ahankara is a very hard and strict protection shield. It is hard because it has to protect the seed of life till it finds the right soil for growth. Once the right soil is found, the ego has to break so that the seed can sprout. Bhagavad Gita comes to Krishna as a parampara. It is Its popular meaning, tradition, is not what Krishna wants to say. Parampara does not have an equivalent term in English. Parampara is a continuous flow. Continuum is its nearest meaning. Rishis have passed on this knowledge through parampara by spoken words. Krishna gives emphasis on the word that is spoken and not what is heard. The person hearing it may not be a rishi, but the person speaking it has to be a rishi. Rishis are persons who have experienced, realized the satya, the truth. Parampara is of rishis who have recognized it and not cognized it. Scriptures are not recognized, scriptures are cognized. Osho has always told his disciples that after I leave the body, don't explain me in your words, which I am doing. People should hear my audios and watch videos directly. To respect his teachings, I would play an audio clip from Gita Darshan. We need to understand his unique style of teaching. This is a clip from the first discourse of the fourth chapter where Osho explains about parampara. It is just a 3 minutes clip. I would for time restrictions, I would wind up first and then we'll go to the audio. Osho and Krishna's message. Enough for today was the way Osho concluded his discourses. Many times he would do so even abruptly. When questioned about it, he would say that we need to stop at a point of time. Whatever is said is like a drop from an ocean. How much ever is told, truth will still remain untold, as truth lies beyond words. But it can be experienced. So he emphasized on sadhana. To understand Gita, we have to become Arjunas. This can be gained by practicing surrender, sakshi bhav, awareness and meditation. So now let us hear the audio. It's just a 3 minutes audio, but Osho explains in a very peculiar, different, unique way. We'll just hear the audio immediately after it comes. And before, I would like to conclude here by thanking all of you for a happy and good listening. And thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to express my thoughts on Osho on his Enlightenment Day, which is celebrated all over the world throughout all countries, practically all countries. So I am very much obliged.
पहली बात तो आपसे ये कह दूं कि परंपरा का अर्थ ट्रेडिशन नहीं है. साधारणतः हम परंपरा का अर्थ ट्रेडिशन करते हैं. ट्रेडिशन का अर्थ होता है रीत. ट्रेडिशन का अर्थ होता है रूढ़ी. ट्रेडिशन का अर्थ होता है प्रचलित. परंपरा का अर्थ और है. परंपरा शब्द के लिए सच में अंग्रेजी में कोई शब्द नहीं है. इसे थोड़ा समझ लेना जरूरी है. गंगा निकलती है गंगोत्री से, फिर बहती है, फिर गिरती है सागर में. जब गंगा सागर में गिरती है और गंगोत्री से निकलती है तो बीच में लंबा फासला तय होता है. इस गंगा को हम क्या कहें? ये गंगा वही है जो गंगोत्री से निकली? ठीक वही तो नहीं, क्योंकि बीच में और न मालूम कितनी नदी है और न मालूम कितने झरने उसमें आके मिल गए. लेकिन फिर भी बिल्कुल दूसरी नहीं हो गई. है तो वही जो गंगोत्री से निकली. तो ठीक परंपरा का अर्थ होता है कि ये गंगा परंपरा से गंगा है. परंपरा का अर्थ है कि गंगोत्री से निकली वही है, लेकिन बीच में समय की धारा में बहुत कुछ आया और मिला. ऐसा समझें कि सांझ आपने एक दिया जलाया, सुबह आप कहते हैं अब दिए को बुझा दो, उस दिए को बुझा दो जिसे सांझ जलाया था. लेकिन जिसे सांझ जलाया था वो दिए की ज्योति अब कहां है? वो तो प्रतिपल बुझती गई और धुआं होती गई और नई ज्योति आती गई। जिस ज्योति को आपने जलाया था सांझ, वो ज्योति तो हर पल बुझती गई और धुआं होती गई और नई ज्योति उसकी जगह रिप्लेस होती गई। वो ज्योति तो छलांग लगा के शून्य में खोती गई और नई ज्योति का अप्रभाव होता गया। जिस ज्योति को सुबह आप बुझाते हैं ये वही ज्योति है जिसको सांझ आपने जलाया था, ये वही ज्योति तो नहीं है, वो तो कई बार बुझ गई। लेकिन फिर भी ये दूसरी ज्योति भी नहीं है जिसको आपने नहीं जलाया था। परंपरा से ये वही ज्योति है, ये उसी ज्योति का सिलसिला है, ये उसी ज्योति की परंपरा है, ये उसी ज्योति की संतति है।
थैंक यू मंजरी फॉर अ वंडरफुल एक्सपोजिशन ऑन ओशो। द फ्लोर इज ओपन फॉर टू और थ्री क्वेश्चंस एंड देन वी कैन मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट पेपर ऑन विनोबा।
Chance to ask a question. My question is that it is good to have such a philosophical discussion or philosophical commentary with the people who are enlightened. That means who knows something about philosophy, who knows about sattva, rajas and tamas. But what about the common people like me? They don't have understanding of sattva, rajas and tamas. And how is there any way Osho has suggested that to appeal, to preach Gita, those who are living in herds, those who are living in the villages, how can we make them, how can we appeal them to preach Gita?
He has given these discourses in Hindi, a very common language for all the Indians to know. And in every discourse, practically every discourse, at least 10 times, he has given different methods of how to. I have given just a gist in some few sentences. It cannot be compiled totally because we have to cover the whole Gita and his all uniqueness. His total uniqueness is also not given. But he has given in every lecture, even in Sattva Raja Tamas in the 17th chapter, I think. I'm not a scholar, okay? I won't remember in which chapter it is. So, talking about Sattva Raja Tamas, it is about 1 hour he is talking on Sattva Raja Tamas. So in 1 hour he has talked a lot. He has talked how to recognize the sattva in you, how to recognize the rajas in you, how to recognize the tamas in you. And he has never said that tamas is bad. He has never said tamas is not necessary. Tamas is always good, lekin uski matra barabar honi chahiye. And he has told us ways how to recognize ki matra barabar hai ki nahi. He has told many ways, but we should hear him originally. If I try to tell what he wants to say, it will be all mess, because I am not a good orator like Osho.
I think as a student, you must listen as well as read Osho more in order to at least get a glimpse of his philosophy and his understanding. In a short time that Manjari has made an attempt on it itself is a great thing, because his philosophy is so direct at one level, at the same time it is so very appealing and reflective. So more we talk about it, I think we are going away from what actually Osho is talking about. Okay. Yeah, we'll take one more question and move on to Dr. Mehta.
Yeah. Just now you said that tamas is good, Osho has said like that. So can you just elaborate on that point?
That is where he has talked about Angulimal and he has talked about Valmiki.
But ultimately they gave up the
tamas. But it is difficult. That is why tamas is not suggested. Because it is very, 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 very difficult. Bahut sankalp hona chahiye. Bahut strong sankalp hai. To hi tamas se ja sakte hai. But people
even ultimately Angulimal and Valmiki, when they gave up tamas, and then shifted to rajas in
they have mind. To go beyond trigunas.
Yeah.
So we have not to get stuck up even in the sattva.
Sattva, yeah, right.
We have to go, we have to take a leap. He has called it as a triangle, like a prism.
Yeah, okay.
So the lower layer is of the tamas. The upper layer is of the...
So which way we can say tamas is good? I feel it has to be given up.
Good, nahin. He has not said good, but he has said not bad.
Okay. So you mean to say if tamas is there, then like strongly...
Yes, sir. Tamas is obstacles.
Yeah.
Somebody likes obstacles, it's fine.
Okay. So as a challenge, they will take up...
Yes, they like to face challenges. Then let them face challenges.
Okay, in that sense. Okay, thank you.
But they have to have a strong will.
Yeah.
Then through tamas you can go. Like Anguli Mala and Valmiki have gone. He has explained it wonderfully.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Said at the end of it, he never used the word as enough for today. Though with the time constraint, we are going to say enough for Manjari. And move on to Dr. Geeta Mehta, who is going to speak on Vinobha's commentary on Geeta.